Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Katie Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Coming up on the show, we have reports from John Russell and Brian Lynn. Jill Robbins presents the Everyday Grammar Report. And we close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, here's Brian.
The European Space Agency, ESA, is reportedly in talks with America's SpaceX to cooperate in efforts to reduce the growing amount of space junk. The talks, reported by Reuters news agency, aim to get the California-based space company to join an international agreement that pushes for policies to fight space debris. It has been estimated that SpaceX satellites represent about two-thirds of spacecraft currently in low Earth orbit. Space debris is anything that humans have put into space that is no longer in use. This could include satellites, equipment, parts of rockets, or spacecraft. Space junk orbits hundreds of kilometers above Earth. It can circle Earth at speeds of about 25,000 kilometers per hour in low Earth orbit. And it can cause major damage if it hits a space station, satellite, or spacecraft. The international agreement that ESA wants SpaceX to join is called the Zero Debris Charter. It seeks to stop any new orbital junk from being created by 2030. The 22 members of ESA have been seeking new members to join the agreement since the agency announced it in 2023. ESA Director General Josef Aschbacher told Reuters that more than 100 countries and organizations have so far joined the agreement. When asked about SpaceX's possible involvement, Aschbacher said ESA was in discussion with the company to possibly sign up. Aschbacher did not provide further details, but he said that work on the charter is moving forward and ESA is continuing raising the issue of space junk with nations and organizations. Reuters reported that SpaceX did not respond to a request for comment on the matter. The news agency said that out of about 10,300 active satellites in space, an estimated 6,300 are part of SpaceX's fast-growing Starlink Internet service system. Reuters said that information came from the U.S. Space Force. Other organizations and nations are also launching their own large satellite collections. China has done so in an attempt to compete with SpaceX, Reuters reported. In addition, American-based Amazon expects to launch more than 3,000 satellites for its Kuiper Internet service over the next 10 years. Jonathan McDowell is a Harvard University astronomer who follows such objects. He has estimated there are nearly 19,000 pieces of trackable space junk in orbit. McDowell said he thinks it is important to have members of industry publicly support this kind of charter. So I'm glad to know SpaceX is considering it, he said. There are no international laws on space debris. But in recent years, countries have begun to create plans and national rules for fighting the problem. We are not a regulatory body. We are a technical space agency, Aschbacher said. But the fact that we have put the charter around the table, which was elaborated with all the other partners, and that they signed up to it, is very encouraging, he added. I'm Brian Lynn.
Researchers in Mexico have discovered a large, lost Mayan city. The major urban settlement, named Valeriana, is hidden deep in the southern forest of Campeche. The discovery adds to existing knowledge about ancient Mayan settlements. Valeriana was discovered by chance thanks to Lidar, or light detection and ranging. It is a technology that uses lasers to map the Earth's surface. The data used for the study came from around 122 square kilometers of high-quality LIDAR data collected in 2013. The work, led by the Nature Conservancy in Mexico, was part of a forest monitoring project called Alianza. The project aimed to reduce emissions from tree cutting, or deforestation, and land damage. Researchers wrote in the study, published by Cambridge University Press, that the discovery of Valeriana highlights the fact that there are still major gaps in our knowledge of the existence or absence of large sites within as yet unmapped areas of the Maya lowlands. LIDAR technology revealed a major settlement filled with buildings and agricultural infrastructure. The classical era Maya civilization dates back to around 1,800 to 1,100 years ago. At the time, the Maya civilization grew its control over present-day southern Mexico and what are now Belize, El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras. In the study, the researchers identified a total of 6,764 structures, suggesting a populous ancient city. The researchers will carry out further detailed study of the data set, both remotely and in the field. The discovery serves as a way to better understand ancient Mayan urbanization and settlements. I'm John Russell.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Thank you.
VOA Learning English, this is Everyday Grammar. Have you ever been in a conversation and wanted to check your understanding? That is the time to use a tag question in English. A tag question is a short question added to a statement. The tag includes a pronoun and its matching form of the verb be, or auxiliary verb. If the tag question is negative, we shorten the phrase, or use a contraction with the auxiliary verb. Here's an example. I was visiting a friend and saw a photo on the wall. I said, "That's a picture of your grandson, isn't it?" My friend answered,
"Yes, it is. That picture is from when he was 2. He's a lot taller now."
In the example, I wanted to confirm something I thought was true. So, I started with a positive statement. "That's a picture of your grandson." Then, I added a negative tag question, "Isn't it?" My friend said I was right. The picture was of his grandson. English speakers use tag questions to encourage a listener to respond. You will often hear teachers using tag questions.
You remember the history lesson from last week, don't you?
Some language researchers say that men use tag questions more often than women. They think it might show that men have more power in the conversation and use tags to ask for information or agreement. Others say women use a certain kind of tag questions to make the conversation run more smoothly. Whatever your gender, when you use a tag question, you expect an answer. The form of that answer depends on the type of tag question. Let's look at the 2 types of tag questions.
We'll talk first about tag questions that follow a positive statement with the verb be. They use a reduced form or contraction. Make the tag question with the form of the verb be combined with the negative not and the pronoun. The verb be has to match the number and person of the pronoun. Take a look at these examples.
They are walking to school, aren't they? She is taking the bus, isn't she? I am supposed to be sitting here, aren't I? You are the math teacher, aren't you?
In these examples, you reverse the order of the pronoun and verb in the tag question. They are becomes aren't they? And she is becomes isn't she? If the statement uses another verb instead of be, the tag question uses an auxiliary verb, such as do or have. For example, in the song A Little Time, the singing duo Beautiful South ask the question,
"Need a little room for your big head, don't you, don't you?"
And,
"Your face has been looking like that for hours, hasn't it, hasn't it?"
If you ask a negative tag question, you expect a positive answer.
Question: "It's raining out, isn't it?" Expected answer: "Yes, it is."
Now let's look at tag questions that follow a negative statement. These are in the affirmative. You can use this to confirm that what you are thinking is true, and you expect a negative answer.
Question: "You don't eat all the cake, do you?" Expected answer: "No, I don't."
Negative sentences with positive tag questions are not as frequent as our first type. They use the same form with reversed word order. Tag questions are an example of a big difference between British and American English. Language researchers using computer data, found that British English speakers use tag questions 9 times as often as American English speakers. In understanding and using English grammar, Betty Azar says that the intonation, or change in pitch, shows the purpose of a tag question. If the speaker is trying to confirm information, the tone rises.
Adam works at VOA, doesn't he?
Speakers saying something that they are almost certain the listener will agree with use a falling intonation.
It's a nice day, isn't it?
I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Jim Tedder.
Now it's your turn. Write a sentence with a tag question in the comments. We'll give you feedback.
We just heard the weekly Everyday Grammar Report. Today it was all about tag questions. Now Jill Robbins joins me to talk a bit more about the story. Can we talk a bit about the word tag?
Sure. It is a word we use to talk about something added on to another thing.
Like a tag question is added on to a declarative sentence.
Exactly. When you go into a store, you might find a small piece of paper that tells you the cost of a product.
A price tag.
You've got it. And in the U.S., we call the number plate on the car a tag, too.
I think I've also heard it in relation to computers and the internet.
That has a similar meaning of a little addition. In social media nowadays, we also use it to mean a short description added on to describe the content. And on a blog post or a website, there are tags in each page that help you when you search for a certain topic.
Tags seem to be everywhere. I just remembered another one, the children's game.
Right. We call it playing tag when we run around and try to touch someone. Then they have to touch another person and say, "Tag, you're it."
Thanks for joining us today, Jill.
It's always fun talking with you and our podcast listeners.
My name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Lesson 51 of the series is called A Good Habit. Today, we're going to talk about habits and about fitness.
A habit is something you do on a regular basis. On a regular basis means something that you do or that happens repeatedly and frequently.
For example, if you brush your teeth every day, you do that on a regular basis. So that means it is a habit.
And fitness is a noun. It means the state of having a strong and healthy body that can do a lot of exercise.
And the word fit is the adjective form of fitness. To be fit, you need to exercise on a regular basis.
And the expression to be in shape means the same thing as to be fit.
Over the last 50 years, running has become a popular way for people to stay fit or get in shape. And a big goal for many runners is to run a marathon. In Lesson 51, Anna thinks she can run a marathon too. Let's listen.
DC is a popular city for marathons. A marathon is a long race. Many marathons raise money for charities, you know, good works. A marathon is a good fitness goal too. I want to challenge myself in a marathon and maybe win a medal. Hey, there's Ashley. Ashley, wait for me. It's Anna. Ashley. 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 Ashley.
Are you okay, Anna?
I just ran from over there. Woo! Running is really, really hard.
Do you want to sit down, Anna?
Yeah.
Do you want some water?
Woo!
No, thanks. You keep it.
Thanks. I didn't know you liked to run.
I love running. In fact, this weekend, I will run in my first marathon.
Me too.
Really? You are running in a marathon?
Yeah, in a couple of days. Why do you ask like that?
What do you know about running in a marathon?
I know that there's a lot of running. And sometimes you can win a medal.
And how long have you been training?
I started today. I've been training for an hour and 7 minutes.
Anna has only been training for about an hour. But to run a marathon, most people need to train for at least a few months.
Or a year. To train or to get in shape is an activity that takes place over a period of time. That's why Ashley and Anna used the present perfect continuous tense.
And how long have you been training?
I started today. I've been training for an hour.
Let's talk a bit more about marathons. The word marathon comes from a town in Greece named Marathon. According to tradition, a Greek runner named Pheidippides ran from Marathon to the city of Athens to deliver some important news.
The news was that the Greek military had defeated the powerful Persian military at the Battle of Marathon. And the distance from Marathon to Athens was about 40 kilometers. After the marathon was added to the modern Olympic sports competition, the official distance of the race became just over 42 kilometers.
And speaking of the modern event, in 2023, a 23-year-old man from Kenya named Kelvin Kiptum set a new world record for the fastest marathon ever run. He ran the Chicago Marathon in a time of 2 hours and 35 seconds.
Whoa. I read that the average time for most people is around 4.5 hours. So that means Kiptum was running more than twice as fast as the average runner. Many people wonder if anyone will ever be able to finish a marathon in under 2 hours.
Well, Kiptum is getting pretty close.
Now let's get back to Anna. She has made the mistake of underestimating how long it takes to train for a marathon.
To estimate is to make a guess about something. And to underestimate means to guess an amount that is too small.
And how long have you been training?
I started today. I've been training for an hour and 7 minutes.
Anna, training a little every day is a good habit to get into, not all at once.
Her friend Ashley is right. To get fit, you need to get into the habit of exercising.
To get into the habit of doing something means to start doing something on a regular basis. And to develop a good habit, it sometimes helps to have a goal. Jill, do you have any fitness goals or things you want to get into the habit of doing?
I swim regularly. I try to swim at least 3 times a week. And every day I do yoga and walk about 3 miles with my dog. How about you, Andrew?
Right now, I think my problem is that I don't have a specific fitness goal. But I do exercise on a regular basis. But you know what? I have a friend who says I don't drink enough water. So maybe I can just get into the habit of drinking more water.
Well, anyway, I think drinking water should be an easy habit to get into. I've been reading a book lately about the habits of successful people. One of them is to start with the end in mind or have a goal, which is good for language learning too. For example, you could say, I want to get in the habit of listening to English at least 30 minutes a day with the Voice of America Learning English podcast. And Andrew, your goal is to get in the habit of drinking enough water. Listeners, did you notice that if we say the habit of, we use the ing form of the verb after it?
For example, we say the habit of drinking more water, the habit of exercising, the habit of reading, the habit of walking, and so on. After the preposition of, just remember to use the ing form.
Anna is not in the habit of running, so she is definitely not going to be able to finish a marathon. But luckily for her, the race she wants to run in is only for children.
I'm here to enter the race. But ma'am, you can't enter the race. What? How am I going to meet my goal? Ma'am, this race is for children. You can't run with the children. Children? Children? That's perfect. I just might win. No, ma'am, you really can't run with the children. I'm sorry, of course. I was only thinking of my goal. Well, you could help us with our goal, which is to raise money for sick children. Would you like to help us?
Anna gets a new goal, to help the race raise money for sick children. At the end of the video, she helps the children and tells them they have done a good job.
I've just found my new goal, and I get to wear a medal. Good job!
Do you have any fitness goals or new habits you want to get into? Send us an email at learningenglish@voanews.com and let us know.
And remember, you can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Dr. Jill.
Show for today, but join us again tomorrow to keep learning English on the Voice of America. I'm Katie Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.